Welcome everyone to this Force Friday. We are going to talk about C torsos, right? If there's one area of the body that I would say is the most important, I would say that it is the torso, right? And as you know, in my books from over 20 years ago now, the system that I placed in there and had written about is the abstraction of letters to discuss the idea of these different torso types. You know, we were talking about this before we came on today. If I created that, I really can't even say, you know. I think I did, but I challenge you guys to find a book or education somewhere prior to, let's say, 2000-ish that had that information in it, because I really don't remember. I really don't remember, honestly. So yeah, if you do find it, please send it to me. I'd love to know. It has to be something that was published, you know, like I said, like prior to it. But yeah. Anyway, my point is because I see CNS and all this stuff used a lot, you know, on the internet nowadays, through Instagram and YouTube and so on. And I wonder if that really started with the Force book. So yeah, check it out. You know, I'm really, really curious to find out. So anyway, C torsos are what we're going to cover today. I also have some really interesting news I want to share with you also. But before we do so, let's say hello to the other Force instructors. How are you doing, Swenley?
I'm doing good. Looking forward to the stream as always. I see a lot of exciting people in the chat. They started the chat even before we went online, so that's a good sign.
It is a good sign. Hopefully you all love each other, you know. We're all here together in the same soup trying to figure out how to draw, right?
Yep.
How are you doing, Mertunjay?
Yeah, good. You know. This was with this week's exciting, and today I think we are going to cover the most common type of torso. So C
Yeah.
torso. I usually
Yeah.
have it's kind of funny, I usually have that scale when I'm teaching. It's like which torso type is the most common one? The C always comes out to be the first.
Yes.
So yeah, good.
Yeah, the C is definitely at the top of things to be aware of when it comes to your templates, right? Like understanding templates and how to draw the body. And it's such an important piece because of that, you know. So you want to make sure that you know this first step, right? I would say even almost more than before you know rhythm. It's like taking the idea of force and how do you take force and actually attach it to the torso itself. Really, really crucial. And we start with the torso, by the way, because, you know, look at the human body. It's like 50%, almost 50% of the figure, and it's the biggest mass, right? Because it's got all these different anatomical components in it that make it the biggest mass, right? So we want that mass. It's like the front of the train, right? That really is driving the body. Right, so we want to try to best understand it as we can. So let's get to it. Like I said, I have some exciting news for you guys. I want to start off with today. Just want to check my audio because I'm going off a different mic today. So you guys tell me how it sounds. I'd love to know. Yep. Okay. So that mic is going. Let's get this camera over here. So the big news I want to share with you. Those of you that follow me on Instagram may have seen this. But I'm finally going to stand behind a particular screen protector for the iPad. And this is only because I bought it on my own. Like AstroPad did not reach out to me and say, hey, can you help promote rock, paper, scissor? I bought this on my own, just in my own interest of trying to find a screen protector that I liked. I used to use AstroPad for their screen share. They did this really awesome app where you were able to take whatever was on your computer and share it over to your iPad, right? So that was kind of cool. It's like, hey, you can draw with Photoshop on the iPad or anything else that you have on your computer over to the iPad. So that was kind of neat. And then in doing a research recently, not that long ago, I found that AstroPad actually made this screen protector and it is pretty darn good. You know, the problem with screen protectors, and I have one on my Cintiq right now, is you're trying to get a little bit of texture, right? You want a little bit of texture when you're drawing because it actually, that a little bit of grip gives you more control. You don't want a lot of grip because then it slows down. It's not very forceful. And you don't want super smooth glass either, like total glass, because it's too slippery. There is such a thing as too slippery. And even the one I have now, It's almost like when you buy these things, there's a, it's hard to explain. It's almost like a little gumminess or something to the surface, and over time, it kind of hardens up or use of your hand on it and so on. I mean, I might as well be drawing on the Cintiq right now, and the screen protector may as well not be on there, right? And that was happening with my prior screen protector on the iPad Pro. So I've tried the AstroPad out. Two things that are awesome about it, well, three actually. Number one, it actually has texture. Hallelujah, right? So there's a little bit of grit in the surface. Amazing. Number two, what's awesome is these black edges that you see here in the image. They have a little bit of stick to them, but they have magnetism, like some magnetics in it, right? So it'll adhere to the screen without you having to like stick the whole thing down on the glass. And it's like having to put a skin on a car. I'm sure most of you know how annoying that is, even on the small piece of glass, to do it without getting bubbles in it. So this was very easy to adhere, very, very easy to adhere. And last but not least, inside this box, this is actually a box, this big red thing that looks like a book. If you, like I said, if you go on my Instagram, you'll see I put a little video of me opening this. Inside there, it also comes with three pen tips. They're the same tip, I believe, but it's got this little metal tip, which ironically, I already have been using a small metal tip for my pencil that a student told me about maybe about a year and a half ago. So I already had one on there. I think it's really smart of them that that's the kind of tip they went for the Apple Pencil. So it just feels like you have more precision. I'm not too fond of some of the other tips out there because they're blunt. Even the Apple Pencil is just a little blunt, so I don't feel like I've got the crispness that I actually want, right? So what's the exciting news? So the exciting news is not only that we found this, but we decided, hey, let's hand some of these out, right? So I reached out to AstroPad and we have three of these screen protectors that we're going to give away to you guys in the month of February. For those of you who have been with us long enough know that every February we try to do something special. We've done like, we did character design for a couple of years, right? And then picked winners and they got stuff on the site. Well, this year we're going to give away these iPad screen protectors. So unless you intend on buying an iPad, and you're like, hey, I'm going to get one after all, like you do need an iPad Pro, right, for the screen protector. So let me make that really clear. What we're going to do is for next week's contest is about gesture drawing. So we want to see the best force gesture drawing done under 2 minutes. And you're going to post that on Instagram to force. Feb draw DR 2024, right? So this is the hashtag right here, force Feb draw 2024. That's where Swenly Mutunji and I will be looking to pick our winner for the first week. And then the following, they'll all be there also. Okay. So force Feb draw 2024. To find out who wins, I'm not going to be announcing it here or on Instagram. It's going to be through email. I'm going to just do it through the website. So let me go and share that with you really quickly. I'm going to show you like where to go there. Okay. So here's drawingforce.com, as you can see, right? Hopefully you all are acclimated with this, right? So here's the homepage. If you scroll down, you'll see the first thing you see is here's the AstroPad Pro screen protector giveaway, right? It's got the hashtag there. If you're not already in the email list, then just enter your email. What happens is we will find out who the winner is, and then I will email blast it out to the entire drawingforce.com community who the winner is, and then get in touch with you, and then we'll get your address and so on and ship out your free AstroPad rock, paper, pencil, screen protector for your iPad Pro. Okay. So that's it. Next week, I will announce what the next contest is. All right, so we'll talk for the next couple of weeks, next 3 weeks, we'll talk about what those different contests are. This is our first contest. We want force gesture drawing. We're looking at under 2 minutes. I want to see the reference, by the way. I wrote that in the notes here on the website. We do want the reference on there so we can see the model. Make sure you cover up any privates, right? So we can post you know, anywhere we want later on. Make sure your name is on the stuff, right? And that's it, right? So hopefully a bunch of you will get engaged in this. I know a lot of you are drawing on iPads, so I'm hoping that this will go out to, you know, a really excited force drawing artist. Yeah, it's going to be awesome. Trust me. The screen protector is great. Okay. All right. So, next step. Next step. The letter C, right? What the heck is this all about? So, one thing I want to make clear is this idea of C's and S's, CS's and RS's, all this stuff. What we are
Thank
not
you. Please
saying,
share Photoshop.
oh, yes, thank you. What we're not saying is, what we're not saying is, don't, we're not asking you to draw the letter C, right? This is abstraction. I came up with these abstractions. I think I came up with these abstractions because it does look like this, right? The simplicity of this is that it looks like this, right? The reason I bring this up is I have seen students, I've taught in classes where students have literally like drawn almost something that looks like this, the letter C. It's like, yeah, that's the abstract, but I want you to draw the human body, right? The C came from the human body, not the other way around. It's not like I saw the letter C and said, I see a body in that, right? Didn't go that way. It came from the human body and then the abstraction, right? So what does a C look like and what does this all mean, right? So I brought in some drawings of mine. I was saying to the guys before how dark my hair was here. It's like, God, I'm going gray. Right. This was actually done for the 10th anniversary edition of the first Force book. So this was shot during that time. Some of you will notice the scene, this room where we took the photographs for the photo pack, right? So this is me drawing over here. And here's the drawing, right? So here's a drawing of Michael the model, Michael the artist, two Michaels. And this is a C torso. Right, so you can visually see the letter C starts to emerge out of this, right? It's like, oh, I can see there's a loop going on here, right? And it goes over the shoulders, around the edge of the rib cage, around the bottom of the pelvis, and into the hip, right? And we'll talk more about this in a moment, but I thought I would come in and just show you some examples of drawings of mine that are exhibiting what we're talking about. Right, we also have these two. The one on the left, I believe is in the character design book, and the one on the right is from the first book as well. So again, C torso. A lot of students will look at something like this and make it an S. Okay, this is not an S. It could be a CS because you'll notice that the pelvis and the rib cage are turning different directions. So I would turn this maybe into a CS, but definitely still a C in here. I still want to feel this pull come in here and come up, right, with this S going on in there also. Last but not least, this is a C torso, right? The reason I grabbed this drawing is because of these orange arrows, actually. And I'm going to talk more about this. But in the C torso, there are three sort of major hits of force. That's one of the definitions of it, one of the requirements, right, of a C torso. And that is this like upper rib cage shoulder area, the opposing bottom of the ribs. And then the opposing pelvis, right? So you got this ping-ponging that goes back and forth within that shape, right? So let's take a look at it, right? I'm going to do some drawing for you and kind of give you the template and the stuff that I think about when I'm drawing it, right? You'll notice here that I did front, back, and side, right? So, because does it change? And if not, like, why not? And what does it look like, right? So let's start with front and back view. So this is the front if somebody was facing you or their back was facing you, right? Let's call this front over here, right? I'll do front here and back over here. So in the front view, one of the first things that you want to pay attention to is you want to think about the shoulders and the pelvis, right? One of the first things I do is I look at this. This is known as contrapposto, right? For those of you that don't know, this is what causes a contrapposto pose, which is an Italian term for this, right? And it creates rhythms in the body, right? It creates all this fluidity. Another way of looking at it is I usually will describe this to students as also an accordion, right? An accordion is that musical instrument that's got all the keys on it, all the buttons, but it sucks in air and blows out air, right? It's like a bellows, right? So that's how it's making sound. I guess it would. I wonder if it's considered a wind instrument because it has keys like a piano, but it's not string like it is, right? It's probably a wind instrument, I would imagine, right? So this contracts here and stretches over here, right? So that's the abstract, right? The abstract of it is a stretch versus contraction, right? So we start turning it into the body, right? And the thing to be aware of is it is stretching, right? It's doing this. So I want force to go like this. And that force will usually come across the top of the rib cage and over to the far side over here, the shoulder, and come down to the bottom of the rib cage, like right here, like so. And then down here, this is usually for me the top of what's called the iliac crest. I see like this angle in the hip. I want to go down lower. I want to go past this to the bottom of the pelvis, right? Here's the crotch, right? So the bottom of the pelvis, come up the other side and then push back in, right? So notice how that starts making sense, right? Like think about how this is pushing out, right? So we have all this pushing out here. Let's get some color in here. Right, so there's a lot of applied force going on here that's been driven from these two moments, right? And I have, you know, directional force going this way. I got directional force coming in like this, directional force coming in like that. And it's pushing, you know, it's pushing its way out here like this, you see? So imagine like taking, you know, taking the top and the bottom of this and pushing your thumbs in on the screen right side, and that's going to help push out the screen left side, you see? So that's kind of how I perceive it, right? It's like I'm pushing in on one side, it's pushing out on the other side. I also think about, because it's the body's volition, right? The model's intention to bring these two together. So this shoulder is coming in and down like this and pushing up like this. Sometimes that drive is coming more from the shoulder. It's like I'm bending my shoulder down and trying to get to my hip. Sometimes they're trying to raise their hip up, right? And it's not so much about the upper body. So those are all those fun, sort of subtle nuances that you can try and find when drawing the figure, right? So remember, I talked about the ping-ponging, right? So that was this image here on the right. Right. So here's this ping ponging that's going on. And this is how I actually came across the CNS torso, which, like I said, I think I came up with. But it's because these are the three main moments, right? We have this moment, we have this moment, and we have this moment, right? So this diagonal to this diagonal, right? These are the three main applied forces of the C torso. You see, they're pushing like that, ping pong, ping ponging. But I don't want to draw it like that. So here's the trap that I can see somebody getting into. Well, I see those three moments. So let me draw the shoulder. I'm going to cut across to the rib cage. I'm going to cut across to the pelvis. Doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make a sen any sense because of anatomy. We'll talk more about that in a little bit. It doesn't work like that, right? There's structures in here that we have to deal with. So it doesn't cut across like that, right? What we're looking for is the idea of bend, right? And that's the mindset, that's the motivation. This is what I'm trying to get into my drawing, which means, by the way, what's going on? You know, we're going to have this sort of inward thrust or like contraction here, right? Over here, when I'm drawing, I'm usually thinking about the model stretching, right? There's a stretch going on over here, right? Those are some of the ideas that are happening. I usually, on the pelvis, I'll think about the upward thrust of this. Right, of the pelvis, so thrust, and I might put the word upward in there, right, to give it more description, like so. So those are the ideas, right? Again, and the ideas matter, right? Your drawing's only as good as your ideas, so this is the stuff I'm thinking about. Okay, how are we doing in the chat? Any, should I field anything? Let's see, Nick's sketch. When I approach a forceful C shape in my design, I typically focus on the pinch more than the pull. When I'm studying the shape, is that wrong? That's a great question. That is a great question, Nick. I usually think more of the stretching at first. This is my first intention, is this. I have to say, this is like my first thing. And then off of that stretch, I'll start here and I'll start thinking about, well, that's happening because the model is pulling their shoulder down. When I draw these blue arrows, for instance, it's not as if an energy from outside is coming in. It's still the model's body that they're pushing in on themselves. So unless something actually makes contact with the model, to me, force is more internal, right? Because it's the model's body that's doing the work. So I don't know if that answers your question or not, but that's how I think about it. You know, or like I was saying here, I'll think about, wow, that's really like pushing up with that hip, but it drives its way inward here from this other two, these other sides, right? From the side of the rib cage and the shoulder and the pelvis, right? And that's helping just create this system. You know, there's this constant system going on here, right? Which is this. You see, like this just keeps going like this in my mind, right? Hopefully that answers your question. So guess what? For the back, I might as well just take this drawing, right? And put it over here because nothing changes, right? It's the same thing, right here. Yeah, it's the same thing. I'm gonna, a better way of doing that would be copy paste, say boom, right? So they're both doing the same thing. You know, those of you that might do turnarounds or orthographic projections, you'll know that the front and back views, the silhouette is the same idea. So this is the same thing. If you're drawing the back, same occurrences, right, as the front view. Now, one thing I do want to present here quickly. Let me flatten that and push it over here. The simplicity of this, right, is to have a curve of force. And again, that reason that curve is there because the other side of the anatomy is pushing it out over here, right? So just be aware of like what the apex is here. I kind of start like this with all the four students, right? And then we get more and more specific. You know, it's like be aware of where that apex really is and where the change occurs. You know, you'll start adding a little more realism to the drawing instead of everything being super spaghetti-like and super flowy, right? Okay, so that's the front and back, right? Front and back, see torso, right? Let's go to the side, right? So here's our side view. So side view, what we want is bend again, but we can bend in two different directions. We can bend forward or we can bend backwards, right? So here's the bend, and I'm going to do it like this. Let's say this is the chest over here. So I'm going to do this. Notice I go along the bottom of the pelvis again, right? Always go along the bottom, down below the crotch, right? Why? Because we want to encapsulate the whole pelvis into this, right? So you want to go along the bottom like that, right? And then we're going to come up over the top and down to the rib cage like so, right? Like this. I can get a little sharper in here if I want. Again, I can look for the apex that's going on here and then understand the stretching down here. Right. So I can get more specific if I want. I can push more force up into the back over here. Notice abstractly, we have still like a letter C, right? But all the energy of it, let's see, swatches, orange. You know, we have all this applied force sitting right here, right? Right here again, and right here. All right. Notice there's no rhythm in this, by the way. Kind of interesting, right? It's one big loop. There's no rhythm. I'm not doing this. I'm not S-ing anywhere. It's just one giant loop of energy that comes in and, like I said, pushes itself out. You see? So something to be aware of. And yet, the moments of curvature in this loop have so much power, right? Power there, again, power there, and power here, right? So that starts to set me up. For, you know, for the side view. Now, if that's the chest facing that way, right? So here's like the lower back. I can reverse this and say, well, now I'm going to have the body bend over, right? Forward. So we can go this way. All right, it's like this, it's coming up like this. Notice the blackness of my line, by the way. Right, I really try to push into these ends, right, into those applied force ends over here. I really want to feel that. I want to feel as I'm drawing. I know I don't feel it, right, because I'm not like touching it, but I do feel it. I get a sense through my hands and the action of how I'm drawing it that mentally I'm stimulated in knowing like I'm pushing energy forward. And the darker I make that line and I keep pounding into it, I start feeling that force pushing forward. I feel this like pushing down, right, as I'm drawing. Now, one last piece here. You know, I have this gap here and here, as you'll notice, right? So I could put a small moment in here. This is the lumbar, or it could be the stomach, right? It's usually like a stiffer area like this. If it gets really bent, like let's say I really bent this torso forward, that straight line in there, that straight line can kind of be covered with wrinkles, right, of the body, right? So this little straight line, I'm going to explode that out, right? So here it is. We're in this like magnified view, right? Here's my straight line, right? This on that straight line could be buried with folds of skin. So the abs, for instance, might be doing something like this. You see, right? But that's still hidden in there. So don't be fooled by not finding that, right? So I'll go over more of this later and as to why, but I want you to be aware that that could be hidden in there, you know, and you can have these folds that kind of like hide it. It could be muscular, it could be fat, right? It could just be thin skin wrinkles, right? But that's basically it, you know? So you can see, visually see, that the C torso is pretty prevalent, you know? It's used very often. And I would say the main issue I find with students' work when they send in their work is that they go to the S too fast, right? The C is actually the powerhouse of all this. So I have a couple of poses I brought in here to share with you. So these were a gift from Proko, right? From a few weeks back when we were working with him. And you can see he got this, I guess, from Graphite, which is on ArtStation. They sell some, I have to say, some really good model photo packs. So here we are. And this is a C torso, right? So I want to try to get that C, right? So here I am. I'm going to come in with soft touch. I want to feel the energy of this. I want to feel how this comes around the bottom. And I like building up the stress. You know, it's like I can feel it in here and I want to get to that shoulder, right? I want to get to that shoulder. I want to get to the bottom of the rib cage, right there. I want this to push out. So you see, I soft touched it. I figured it out. And now I'm like, whoa, man, that's nice right there. Right? Feel that pushing out. Right. Then it's coming down. There's a lot of stretch going on here as well. So that straightens out a little bit more. The straight line, the curved line there is very straight, right? And then I'm going to come along the bottom, right? All the way around the bottom and come back up. And oh, guess what? That place I was talking about, that little straight that might be sitting in there, you could see his anatomy is sitting in there and kind of folding in on itself, right? So, you know, I've got this, I got this. So there's my first one. I can then add on to this later. I can add the lats and the anatomy. I like pushing off the shoulders like this and seeing how they sort of billow out of that shape. You see, I can like pull the deltoid off of there and then get the arm out of there. You see here, I can build this up. You know, it's almost like the tunnel here that I call it, where whoops, where the arm comes out of the from underneath the deltoid, right? Like so. So, you know, there it is, right? Like this is how it starts. Right. So it's like I see that abstract, and then out of that abstract, I start building out. Right. So look at how much information I can get out of that C torso. Does it look like a letter C? Like, is this my drawing? No, but that is the abstract icon of that, you see. And the jump I made when I was teaching was like, oh, how can I teach this in a simple way to create a system? It's like that looks like the letter C. Okay. So that's one. I have one more to show you. Same situation as to where I got all this, right? This is from Stan a little ways back, and it looks like I said he got it from Graphite. And let's do this one, right? So I got the top, I'm coming down, right? I pay attention to the angles, by the way. You know, like I want to push this out. I just looked at her, I'm like, oh, son of a gun. She's not straight. She's slightly left of straight, right? My brain doesn't want to do that. I want to do this. I want to push that rib cage out, but that's not what's going on. She's actually like here. She's already slightly going to the left-hand side. And then there's a big change right there where that angle gets stronger, right? And then I want to feel that push in this hip here, right? Remember, along the bottom, I want to get along the bottom. I want to feel the change. I want to feel the stretch. I want to get along the bottom here and then bam, right? Look at that. And that'll take me down the leg later, right? But bam, that is power right there. Lots of power. Right, and then we come up, I come back up and over, and I come down. Right, notice I'm getting the angle of the shoulder. So I'm using this to give me that angle. I'm using this to give me this angle. Right, we have all this going on. If I were to get into form and stuff on this, I would have said, you know, even getting ellipses in here would help me, like at least push that back a little bit in space, right? Because it's pretty d dynamic, you know. The horizon line's very low in this shot, so we're looking up at her. So not only do I have the force of the pelvis, you know, and getting the C torso in here, but also there's a lot of perspective, right? And then I'd go through the same process. You know, I would have come down the leg on this one because that's the strong leg, and that would have been my outside inside outside leg, and then get the other leg. You know, I would have gotten this out here, and then the arms, and you know, with the arms again, I would pull off of the you know, I would pull off of the torso, right, to get all that set up. So that's it, right? This is our starting point, right? The number one first template you really end up dealing with through my force books and drawingforce.com is getting this C torso down and understanding that you're imbuing it with force. It's an object, right? This blob. And you're trying to figure out where all those pushes and stuff are, right? Okay, any questions before I hand it over? Let's see, so graffiti also sells packs, yes. 20 of 10, you guys are ready for those 20-minute drawings. okay, looks like everything's good. All right, so let me hand this over. I believe Mutunjay is coming up next. Let me give you control. I always forget to do this before. So there you go. And Swenley as well for later. There you go. All right, Mutunjay, it's all yours when you're ready.
All right, I'm ready.
All right.
Let's see. Start. Take the screen share. I'm going to take the screen share off of you. All right. So let's see. Okay. All right, guys. Thank you, Mike, for the awesome introduction. And now we are going to start with the specific of the C torso. Okay. So you have learned the rhythms and like how they are getting affected and like what is the function and everything. So that's the first thing, right? That's the first thing you do, which is like getting the function right. And then like going into like more and more details. So this is the first detail. The first detail would be what makes up that C torso. Like obviously we are talking about a torso. So the volumes are, you know, that relationship is what we have to talk about. Okay. So the first thing is the two main volumes, okay? The two main volumes, now because you're talking about the torso, it's going to be the rib cage and the pelvis, okay? So here I have like a very normal, like a neutral pose, okay? And then the thing is, yes, we are talking about these two things. So you have to be aware that we have a rib cage, like that's just going to be a normal rib cage like this. Okay, and then we will do have the spine, you know, which is going to connect the two, basically the volumes. Okay, and then that would be the rib cage and the pelvis. So this is what we are dealing with. Okay, we are dealing with one volume, we're dealing with another volume over here. You can draw them in any way you want to. I'm just going to cover the simple ones. There's like many ways to do it. I think just the boxes are the best way to do it just because, I know, like it gives you like a very clear turning edges, right? Turning edges basically means, now any of you guys been you know, sticking with us for a long time, you would know it. But any of you don't know, well, the turning edge is the edge that that separates, you know, the plane changes. Okay, so here you see this plane is going like that, this plane is going like this. So basically, that would be called the turning edge. Here, this one, and these edges, like they are all turning edges, you see. So yeah, basically the thing is, yep, you know, like these two volumes is what we are dealing with in any torso. That could be an S torso, C torso, you know, CS, whatever. But the thing is, you know, the relationship between these two volumes is what's going to describe which torso template you would be having. Okay. So what happens in a C torso? We're just going to discuss like what happens in a C torso, and that you can clearly see over here. So a pretty strong C torso over here, as you can see. Yeah, and then what is really happening as you have to be aware of these points, okay, that the point that I'm describing right now. So these are the two volumes, like right from the front. And you see like these four points over here, like these four points. And then based on these four points, you can understand if the current torso that you are viewing, it's a sea torso or not. So what really happens is they tilt, okay? These volumes are independent, by the way. Yeah, they can move together or they can move independently, right? So the top one, that's a rib cage, okay? The bottom one is the pelvis, like that. And you see what happens as these two points and starts to come closer together, and these would start to go away from each other. So what really happens? This forms a and again, try to connect it from the rhythm thing that Mike mentioned, you know, which is basically, oops, sorry, like this, yeah. So see that this is what's happening, okay? So the rib cage is tilting, and the pelvis is tilting, and what is really happening is the two of the points are coming closer, and then two of the points on the other side, they're going away from each other. So this would form a squash, okay? This is what we call like a squash. I think some of you are mentioning the beanbag. Yes, you know, yeah, you can call it like a beanbag. And then these two points, you see these two points, they're going away from each other. So this would form a stretch. So that is how we are coming up with a function called stretch and a squash. And that is basically the sea torso, right? Sea torso is just another or simple name or associated letter been given to the function of stretch and squash, right? So something like this. And that is the relationship between the two volumes, you know, basically in the torso. So if I have to like draw this one so you can actually see, the shoulders are tilting this way, and then the rib cage would be on this angle over here, and then the pelvis, oops, the pelvis would be on this angle right over here, and then you can see like these two points are coming closer, and that's why that is where the squash is being created. Now on the other side, obviously, the stretch would be created. So that is what's happening over here. Now from the two volumes, we can go to center line, okay, which is the next concept that's going to make that relationship between the two volumes like more stronger, and then it will help you to connect it, okay? So what do we have here? We have I have another reference over here, and center line. So what is center line? We can talk about center line here. It's basically I also call it natural centers, or everybody calls it in a way. So natural centers,
I think I came up with that too, by the way, natural centers.
Already. Oh, man.
I'm going to own all these. I'm owning all this vocabulary, damn it. People yeah. normally call it landmarks, right? That's what you'll find in a lot of books, anatomical landmarks. And I think I came up with, you know me, I like coming up with terms. So I think natural centers, yeah, go find natural centers in a book prior to 2000.
Yeah. Guys, find everything this week.
Yeah, exactly. Prove yeah. me wrong. Prove me wrong.
Yeah, see if we can bring down Mike, you know.
Exactly. Exactly. Bring it down. Bring down the tower.
But I'll be happy, you know. And yeah, if you find out that you you came up with those terms, that would be amazing.
Yes.
All right. So we take Mike's awesome term, center line, right? And then we see like how that is applied, you know, towards the body. And you can see what's happening. This might not be the best picture, but you can see like our line that's coming from the middle of the body going, it starts from the pit of the neck going all the way to the crotch. And yeah, I mean, it is visible on the body. That's why it's called natural center or center line. Now, it's not just on the front side, but also on the back side. So here, you can see Mr. Mike Mattesi again taking a picture. So that's Mike's shoes.
Yes.
Yeah. That's exactly. Mike's legs there.
I designed those shoes, by the way.
You're coming up with everything.
Yes. That's my fashion right there. I designed those.
Yeah, it looks good. I mean,
thank you. Yeah, squared off tip. You know, I like angles, so squared off. Yeah.
It looks forceful.
Yes. <laughs> You know? It looks like I'm kicking the pro model in the face in this picture. You know? Either that or my foot stinks. One of the two. She's like, dear God, like put some odor killers in those shoes.
So this is like what? This is like this, you know? And then
exactly.
like
Exactly.
that.
All right. A model.
Yeah, but you guys can see like how much yeah, like this is like a, such a good angle, you know, from the top 3/4, and I think there's another picture to this one, if I'm not wrong, in the model pack, from a different angle. Yeah. So who's taking this picture, Mike?
My friend Mark.
Oh, okay. That's awesome.
Yeah, we were both shooting at the same time. Trying to take
Great.
as many pictures in a short amount of time as possible so the models don't get burned out, you know?
Right. So yeah, you guys can see there's also like a center line running from the back, and that's just a spine. So yeah, we have like center lines in the front and in the back. Now, what is it used for real? Like, how do you use it, or what it is useful for? You know, so basically, let's say you have a rib cage, you know, and you have the pelvis, and that's again a C relationship. Okay, the stretch and squash, basically. So the thing is, you can draw the center line, okay, like this. So that would obviously connect both the parts, but also it gives you is some volume, okay, and then it also is able to convert the C torso into like base, like other relationships, okay. So I'm not gonna talk too deep about it, but for example, you know, let's say I have a rib cage, which is again kind of looking at this way. I usually use this kind of metaphor, by the way. So I usually put in the eyes and I say, "Oh, rib cage looks there," you know, and yeah, as in pelvis, you know, kind of,
Yeah,
well,
it's kind of weird on the pelvis.
yeah, I know, but maybe it
Maybe
could be on the underpants, you know, that would be more
saw
weird.
maybe each eyeball is on the corner of the hip, you know, at the iliac crest.
I don't think can claim
Yeah,
his own invention now. Eyes on the torso.
that's right. Well, actually now, yeah, Mutunja, you can claim, that's right, that you did that.
Yeah. That's a little weird thing to claim, but
Yes, the creator of eyeballs on the pelvis.
oh my God. Yep.
It's your claim to fame.
It might be in the 10th anniversary clothing book.
Exactly.
All right. So yeah, we were talking about this, right? Which is basically let's say spine's coming from back, and it's and see the pelvis is now looking this way, you know, this that way. And then you see what happens all of a sudden now the C torso starts to become a CS, you know, like in a way. So we might hit the CS torso sometime in the future. We have done like obviously things on this on the past as well, past frames, but you can see like how important this is, right? So now it is taking us into another function, okay, just changing that, okay, otherwise everything remains same, right? The squash here remains same, the stretch here, okay, the center line, great, you know, great. Again, just like Mike said, it's like landmarks as well. And then, you know, that center line takes us into like a little bit of anatomy, right? So what is that? What is an anatomy thing? I have to grab a picture from here again. Yeah, this one. So I'll take this picture, okay? Let me see if I can shift that to anatomy. Okay, I think I can. Very good. Yeah, so some anatomy. So basically where the center line is coming from, yes, it's running down the center of the front and the back as well, but where it's coming from. So let's say again, I have to draw these eggs, you know, all the time. But it's fun. And this is like a simple rib cage, you know. We have another. So I'm just like using a box here, just for the pelvis. And yeah, so that's the central leg coming from. Now, talking about anatomy, like this, it starts from the pit of the neck and it goes all the way to the crotch, like I said. So this central line, the top portion, that's coming from the chest, right? Between the chest. They basically, let's say you have scapula over here, you have the arm. See, like that's your pec muscle right there. So, and then another pec muscle, obviously on the other side, maybe on that side, like that. And then here's a collarbone, right? So you basically like have this like whole pec muscle right over there. And see, this is where it starts from, right? And center, as you can also see on the model. So it's like basically this is the pec, right? All the way there, all the way coming over here. and the send line starts from there, pit of the night. Okay, just remember that. Then it continues right like from the abs, right? So 1, 2, 3, 4, you know, just in general, the belly button would be here actually. So it's continued like all the way by the abs, right? Like there. And there we go. So from the front, it's made out like that. From the back, though, it's just a spine. So you don't have to like use a lot of brain cells, basically. Let's say I have a C torso again, you know, I can just like draw the spine. You just need to know the rhythm of the spine, basically, by the way, right? The rhythm of the spine, if you are just going from the side view, it's just going to be inside, outside, inside, outside. Why I'm calling it inside first? Well, basically the neck is here, or the head, I should say. The head is over this way. And then, oops. And then we have the rib cage, you know, over here, then the pelvis over here. So inside, outside, right? So this is like what the rhythm of the spine is. So yeah, basically you do the same thing, right? So again, the neck. Okay, neck here. So inside, outside, inside. That's straight there represents this like lumbar region of the spine, and then we have the outside again for the butt side. Okay. All right. So that's some anatomy over there. How much time do I have? Do I have any time left?
You're about out of time. Yeah,
All right, man. All right, guys. Anyway, so yeah, that's a few things about C torso. So Annie's gonna show you some awesome drawings. So yeah, let's move.
thank you, Mutunjay.
Yeah, very welcome.
Yes, thank
Thank you,
you for
friendly.
the eyes on the pelvis. We can never unsee it.
Exactly. I order my pair of buttons this week.
All right, guys. Let's talk about force shape and how that applies to drawing the torso. So, in dealing with force shape, no matter what the subject is, it always comes back to this. Now, so remember the basic force shape rules, and you basically want to avoid these shapes here at the top. And the reason for that is that they are static. You know, if you compare it to the shape at the bottom, these have like a clear direction, so they look like they're doing something or going somewhere. So they are more dynamic and fluid, and they are appealing because of contrast. So remember the basic shape rules. You know, you want asymmetry through straight to curve design, and you want to avoid symmetry as much as possible. So having said that, in dealing with a torso, what you don't want to get into is stacking egg shapes on top of each other. Now, this gives you like a sense of volume, but in terms of fluidity and appealing shape, this doesn't do the job. Again, it's going back to these guys up here. Now it will look static and stiff. So we need some asymmetry in the torso. So avoid this. Now we also call this snowman structure. So it's time to take the snowman out in the sun, let it melt. Let's move on to forceful shapes. So having said that, if you're dealing with a perfect front or back view of a torso in a neutral position like this, it's symmetrical. You know, it is what it is, just like looking at the head in front view. So it's symmetrical, you know, like the rhythm occurs more the side view of the torso. But if you're dealing with a front view, it's symmetrical. It is what it is. But as soon as we have some stretching and squashing action, as like you can see here, then we start getting into more force shapes. So Mike already talked about the forces. Now Mitunjay covered the structure. So here you can see the shape design. And if you look at the core, for example, so let's grab this color so it shows up a bit better. So if you look at the core, notice that like Mike showed you that you have the bend on one side, which is the curve, which is here. And this would be the straight right here. You know, so this is like the simplification. But We have the obliques, at the sides, and once you bend your torso like this, you're going to squash the oblique between the bottom of the rib cage and the top of the pelvis. So usually this mass will like bulge out a little bit. Now I'm gonna give a little curve there. But no matter what, if you look at the shape that is highlighted here, you can see that it's asymmetrical. Now, so notice that we have this long curve here, we have a smaller curve here. So it's still asymmetrical and appealing. And when you bend to the other side, of course, it's the same, just the opposite. And like Mike mentioned earlier, it's the same in the back view. Now, the only thing that would change is you would see the anatomy of the back. But function-wise and shape-wise, it's basically the same. So that is the front view. Then if we go to a side view, we start with the torso in a neutral position, like Metuni showed you guys. The natural rhythm of the spine would create an S-curve in this case. And then let's say the torso bends backwards, as you can see here. So this arrow here indicates the leading edge, like it's the direction that the upper body is going in. So we have the stretch of the front, and very important is this straight moment back here of the lower back. Now here's where you would have like the erector spinae muscles, which create like this strong straight here at the back. So this is a key moment. Now, what you don't want, again, if you're dealing with like these egg shapes, you will lose that. You would have some that is too round back here. And normally this is pretty straight. It's like a strong pillar of support, like supporting the weight of the back of the rib cage there. And then when you bend the torso towards the front, same idea. Now the curve is at the back, of course, and then the straight is here, the stomach. But like Mike also mentioned earlier, here's where you would have, you could see like, because you have the abs and the stomach, and depending on how much body mass is here in the front, you will see like a pinching starting to take place, so you would see compression, you could see like smaller folds of the skin. But on a very basic level, this is the straight moment. Like this is now the pillar of support that's like holds up all this upper structure here. So those are the front, back view, side view. Now let's take a look at how this applies to dealing with the figure. So let's see if we can get like maybe two torsos done here. So if you look at this, you can already see the ideas that you showed earlier, and maybe it's handy to, let's bring this over here and let's draw over the photo so you guys can see how we see. I think that is always helpful. Okay, so let's zoom in here. So first order of business, of course, we have this bending, or you could say a stretch here at the back. Now see this long curve. Notice that I'm starting like at the bottom of the torso all the way to the top, like force is driving all the way up here. Then it's going over. And because he's pushing out his back, notice that we have a very straight moment here. Now, like very, very straight and simple. Don't get distracted by all the like little bumps. Look for the simplicity first. Now this is a very simple straight. You can see the compression here, the stomach, lots of little folds there. And we go over the bottom of the torso. And on the farther side, you would have a straight, the farther side of the pelvis. And so this basically gives us the simple shape. And then we could add some structure, like the bottom of the rib cage would be around here. And it would be like the top of the pelvis. So you can see your stomach is very compressed. That's why we have all those little skin folds happening here. Now this is under a lot of stress. Now we could add the V shape. Now we could add think of the underpants form. Like in this case, he's really pushing his thigh up high. So this socket would be all the way up here. Now this one is in a more neutral position. and then the thighs like pop out of those sockets. Now you have the like the opening for the neck up here. Oh, but look for the simple shape. And when you're working with shape, it really helps to tone things in so you don't just see the line, you can see the shape. So let's quickly use the lasso fill tool here. And there we have the shape. Okay, I think we have time for maybe one more. So let's take a female this time. Well, she's also bending forward. Let's actually take this guy. And let's draw this. So as you can see, lots of stretching happening at the front. Now this all stretching, stretching, stretching. Now that's kind of like starting to fall. And even now I want to make sure that I'm bending him enough. Also, this is stretching. His pelvis is pretty much in a neutral position. The bending really happens at the rib cage. Now, like once we go past the pelvis, this starts to bend, and this is at an extreme angle. So I'm aware of those angles as I'm making the drawing. And basically, we have the edge of the rib cage here. Now, this would be our straight. So notice if you ignore all those little skin wrinkles and you look for the simplicity of what's going on, we have a very simple straight in there. And then we have this side of the pelvis. And again, we can start building some ellipses in here to add some form. And we can look for the pit of the neck. Center line is very clear. So we can bring that in here. You can see the V shape. Now that goes towards the crotch. You can think of the underpants structure again to find the sockets for the thighs. Also simple and clear. And once you have this simplicity, then you can continue building on top. You know, and maybe then later you can go in and like add some of those little skin folds on top. But start with a very simple straight to curve shapes. All right. I think this is about time. So hopefully this was helpful. You know, we saw very great questions and great responses in the chat. So we want to see some great sea torsos as you guys participate in the contest in the coming weeks. All right, Mike, it's all yours.
Alrighty, let's see. Get that over here back to Photoshop. So that's pretty much it, guys. I hope that you enjoyed today's session. As Swami just said, you know, go home and practice those sea torsos. That should be the first place you go. Not only the torso, but the sea torso. Before you go to the S or the CS or the RS or any of those others, start with the C and see if it works, right? If it doesn't work, then you start looking at why doesn't it work? It must be one of these others. So that's the first thing. The second thing is remember, do not enforce the template on the model. Instead, draw the model and try to find out which torso starts to emerge. So you don't fall in the trap of just going out there trying to draw templates, right? It's like trying to find it. In time, you'll just be able to look at a photograph and go, that's a sea torso. And that's about as far as you have to really think about it. Just go draw the model, right? But at least that template is telling you its main ideas. You know, what are the main bullet points of, or the main characteristics of a sea torso or an S torso and so on, right? So I leave you with that. Hope you enjoyed today's session. And, you know, we were talking about 200 a lot. So we'll see. It's right around the corner, right? Today is 196. Can't believe it. So
Maybe 200
196 sessions.
torsos.
Yeah, 200 torsos of all different types. Yeah, it might as well be the seal at that point then. So we were talking about seals earlier. I'll just put some of Mutunjay's eyes on it. And we'll have seals. You know, I'm trying to think if there's anything else. I don't think so. I will be talking to you guys from Mexico next week. If anyone lives in Mexico or is traveling to Mexico, I am doing a workshop in Mexico City next weekend. You can sign up for that at drawingforce.com. It's in the workshop page. So just go to the workshop page for that. It'd be great to meet you in person, of course. And a repeat of just what we talked about before, very quickly. We are doing this contest. This month, right, we're going to do it 3 weeks in a row where you can get your own AstroPad iPad Pro screen protector. Really awesome. If you're not even interested in the contest, that's fine. If you're going to get a screen protector, this is one I recommend, right? It's really good. I really enjoy drawing on it. It brought back newfound interest in me drawing on the iPad. I don't use it that often, and it made me want to draw on it again. So check it out. Thank you, Mrtunjay and Swenling, as always, for your great work. And we will see you guys. We'll see you next week. Take care, everyone.
See you
Hi
guys.
guys.
See
Here.
ya. Bye-bye. All right, we're out.